Good morning. Welcome to the First Congregational Church of North Brookfield. To kick off our service on this beautiful Palm Sunday, please enjoy a selection from our chime choir. Before we get started with praise and worship, we have an incredible anniversary to help celebrate. It's Don and Betty Dorwood's 68th wedding anniversary. So let's sing to them and celebrate that miracle.
Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary.
Okay, just start over. That was just you.
Cause in the highlands and the heartache, you need the most. You're just not that hard to find. I will praise you on the mountain, and I will praise you when the mountain's in my way. You're the summit where my feet are, so I will praise you in the valleys all the same.
In the highlands and the
thought that I was too far gone for everything I've done wrong. Yeah, I'm the one who dug this grave, but you called my name. You called my name. All at once I came alive. This beating heart, these open eyes, the grave let go. The darkness should have known. You're still rolling stones. You're still rolling stones. You're still rolling, rolling. You're still rolling stones. You're still rolling, rolling. You're still rolling stones. You're still rolling, rolling. You're still rolling stones. You're still rolling
stones. On a hill called Calvary stands an endless mercy tree. Every broken, weary soul, find your rest and be made whole. Stripes of blood that stain its rain, shed to wash away our shame. From the scars, pure love release, salvation by
in the sky between two thieves hung the blameless Prince of Peace, bruised and battered, scarred and scorned, sacred head pierced by our thorn. It is finished was his cry, the perfect lamb.
And all God's people said.
If you put the mask on before the microphone, there's a problem. Welcome to First Congregational Church, North Brookfield. It's good to see you all here on Palm Sunday. For announcements, we put our announcements in our newsletter, and so our newsletters are available online at our website. Our newsletters are available if you'd like to receive them by just sending an email to prayer@firstchurchnb.org, and you can receive the newsletters directly every week, you know, as they come out. If you don't have access to email, you can have them mailed to your house. Just call the church phone number and leave your contact information. And right now we take the time to look at prayer requests. These are requests that need to be shared among the body, you know, for urgency or just because we really need to know these things. For other prayer requests or more personal requests, you can send an email to prayer@firstchurchnb.org. And you can do that during the service. You can do that at any time. Wake up at 3 in the morning, you can send an email. It'll be looked at in the morning, most likely. But you can do that. Things that I just want to make you aware of that I'm already aware of. One was just to highlight what we already did, but happy anniversary to the Dorwoods, 68 years. We're going to be talking this morning about a covenant relationship, and what better example than 68 years. What were you doing 68 years ago? I wasn't doing anything. I had plenty of free time. So we are thankful for an anniversary celebration. We want to be praying for Brad and for his sister Monique. Monique has pneumonia and Brad has COVID. Monique has COVID, and they are other members of their family that are wrestling with this. So we really want to amp up prayers for Brad and for his family right now. We want to continue praying for Karen and for healing of her foot, yet she's still in her pew this morning, right there. That's awesome to see you back. And we want to continue to be praying for Holly Smith. I'm going to go over and visit with them after church today and pray with her, but still she is on a trajectory of doing well. And thank you. Thank you. That's just amazing. So we continue to pray loudly. Let's continue to pray. So other requests that I need to be aware of. Nancy.
Ray Heber.
Thank you.
John. Don't forget about the time of Easter on Monday, Thursday.
Yes, I have a whole slide for that. So, and do you have an update on Ray? Okay. We'll be praying for Ray. Anything else before? Yeah.
My mother's neighbor, Ginny, passed away on Thursday morning. We prayed for her last week, but just please keep her daughter, Nancy, and granddaughter, Ashley, in prayer during this time.
I got Ashley, and you said Nancy before that?
Nancy is her daughter, yep. And Ashley is her granddaughter.
Okay, thanks. Okay, let's pray and we'll conclude with the Lord's Prayer. Father, we thank you for the gift of prayer, to be able to just stand united together, crying out to you, praising you. Lord, we just thank you for the Dorwoods and for 68 years of marriage. We just praise you for that, Lord. Lord, we pray for Brad, for Monique, for their family, Lord, that they would be recovering quickly, that symptoms would not be severe, that side effects would not be obstacles. We just continue to lift them up. Lord, we thank you for Karen being back, and we just pray that you'd continue to heal those bones. Lord, we pray for Nancy and for her family over the loss of their mom. We pray for Ashley. We lift up Ray Hebert to you, Lord, that you would heal him as well. We pray for Evelyn during this time. And Lord, we just praise you for Holly, and we continue to pray for a continued and progressive healing. And Lord, we just look for all of the people that are ill to be back with us. We look forward to the day when all of those on Zoom will be back with us. We look forward to the day when all of those watching later on YouTube and Facebook will be back with us. We look forward to the day. And we just pray, Lord, that during this time that you would continue to unite us by your Spirit. In your holy name we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, so I just hit the wrong button and I would have taken a picture of me. Not helpful. Okay. All right, we've already done the say cheese. I just want to make you aware of everything that's going on this week. This is Holy Week. Today is Palm Sunday, if you're not aware of that, the day that Jesus entered triumphantly into Jerusalem on a donkey, where everyone proclaimed Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. On Thursday of this week, not Wednesday, we've been doing our Lenten services on Wednesday. This week it is not on Wednesday. This week it's on Thursday. And we have a tenebrae service. Sometimes it's called a Maundy-Thursday service. And this is just a time of reflection, meditation, communion, and we'll share communion with each other. There are readings. The lights are dimmed with each reading to the point of darkness as we move towards Good Friday. It's a very beautiful service. If you're able to come, we'd invite you to come. We are not going to Zoom or record or upload that service. But what we are doing is encouraging you, if you cannot make it, to at your home, gather your family, have a communion time of communion together, break bread, and share a cup together and remember what this day is. That would be a good thing for you to do. But we're not going to be Zooming, logging in, recording. Those that are here are just going to be reflecting on everything that Thursday represents. On Friday, the church will be open from noon to 6 p.m. Feel free to stop in and pray. There'll be someone here to pray with you, and just to have the doors open. There'll be, you know, light music playing, and you can come in and pray anytime. You can come in for 5 minutes and leave. You can come in for the whole, you know, 6 hours if you want to quietly pray. But it's just a time of reflection. So if you do come in, respect the fact that other people are praying, and it's not a time for, hey, how you doing, and conversation. This is a time to pray. So please, you know, stop in. Spend some time praying on Friday. On Sunday next week, this is key, on Sunday next week, so that families can connect together, we're not going to be doing a sunrise service this year. We can't do the breakfast this year, but we are going to move the morning service to 9:30. That's not the beginning of our summer hours. This is just next week, okay? So come next week at 9:30. Don't come at 10:45. I may still be speaking. No. No. But come at 10, no, scratch that. Come at 9:30 next Sunday. And then the following Sunday, come at 10:45 for the start of the service again. Okay, so this is the Holy Week schedule. It is in our newsletter, and it's on our website, the newsletters. I've already said all of that. Okay, so let's jump into where we are in Judges right now, and let's remember when. Before, though, we want to go over, because if you have been here, going over just very briefly what we're doing is still important to continue to wash that over us. If you're new and you haven't seen or been here for the previous sermons in Judges, then this is a good way for you to get up to speed very quickly. You don't have to know all of what's in Judges that we've already covered to be able to know what I'm talking about today, but it's helpful. And you can always go back online and watch and catch up as well. So see, some of the things that we've been talking about, the title of the book, The Judges, it's kind of an inaccurate title for us today, because today we think of judges as being judicial, judges being, you know, sitting at a bench at court. And the judges that are being talked about in this book are more deliverers of the people of Israel. They're more savior-like templates than they are judges. They're tribal leaders. We've said that each of the judges are a judge of a particular tribe or area of Israel, but they are symbolic of all of Israel. But we have to understand that each of the judges are more of a smaller area within Israel, kind of like this different states within New England are all part of New England. And we've also said that the book of Judges is a progressive downward spiral of deterioration, a progressive downward spiral spiritually, a downward spiral of conforming to the people of the land that they are supposed to be casting out, and the idols and the idol worship and the child sacrifice, the different things that are going on in these areas. They're supposed to be pushing them out, but they're conforming and they're acting in a morally, you know, progressively downward spiral. There's more confusion, there's more doubt, there's more darkness, and the whole book doesn't end well. When you read this book, you walk away going, it's not right. And I have problems. It shouldn't end so much in a lost state. But what we said is that this book is written for us to use as a tool to say, what went wrong? How do we prevent those kind of things ourselves? And we also said that as we deal with very difficult issues, difficult questions today, we always have to remember that God works in the context of the culture. God works in the context of the culture. Jesus didn't come and abolish slavery. Jesus came and started something that would abolish slavery. Jesus didn't come and have women apostles, but he started something that brought women into a whole different place of being able to sit at a rabbi's feet. And so Jesus is the, and God work in the context of the story, and faith is a story. If we get angry with this scene, we can't walk out any more than we can get angry with a scene in a movie and say, that's a bad movie. Because we want to wait until the end of the show to make a judgment about the movie. And so it is in God's story. We can't make judgments on a scene in the middle of an act, in the middle of a section, in the middle of a larger story. So God's story spans thousands of years. God's story is still being played out, and we are characters in that story. And lastly, just the structure of the book of Judges. We've been dealing with this first section from chapter 1 to chapter 2, verse 5, where there's foreign wars, and then at the end of the book, there's domestic wars, and then the middle is foreign idols and domestic idols, and then there's this cycle of judges that we're getting very close to arriving on. Today, we finish this section, foreign wars. So this is all of what we've been looking at. This is the whole of it all. And we said that at the top and the bottom, God speaks. He speaks there at the top and the bottom. And in this middle area, there was this whole section of the tribe of Judah going forward. And we just explained the tribe of Judah. And today, I'm going to mention a lot of names. Asher, Naphtali, Manasseh, all kinds of different names. Each of these names are names of the 12 sons of Jacob, who became nations. And so what we're looking at when you see all these names, it's the descendants of the 12 sons of Jacob, okay? So we looked at Judah, a descendant of the sons of Jacob. Now we look at Joseph. We're gonna look at this today and the last section of God speaking. That's what we're looking at today. And if you have the books, by the way, we have books that have the text of Judges on one side and notes on the other that a number of people have. If you're interested in one of those books, just see Judy after today. Is that a better way to do it? Yeah, if you would like a book to write in, we got one here. Anyone else would like a book? We've got quite a few, so just Judy's getting it, but oh, got it. All right, great. So remembering is a very important concept in Scripture. Remembering is a very important concept personally in our lives. So 5 years ago, on Annie and I, at that time I was taking Fridays off, Annie was taking Fridays off. The Friday closest to June 29th, which is the day that Annie and I went on our first date, the day that we met, June 29th, 1980. So anyways, 5 years ago, we decided that we were going to have a day of remembering. And so we drove all over the place in Worcester County to places that meant something to our relationship. And so we started with the house that I grew up in Worcester. And we just decided we were just going to remember and take a picture of each place and then have a conversation about that place, either on the way or on the way back. And so we started in Worcester, Hadwin Park area in Worcester. That's the house that I grew up in. And then, just remembering. And then we went over like 3/4 of a mile away on the Auburn side to where Annie grew up. And so we took a picture there. And then we drove to the Paxton Inn, which is now the Country Bank. You see, we've outlasted, the Paxton Inn. The Dorwoods have outlasted many, many, sites, I'm sure. And so this is where our first date happened. We went to the Paxton Inn a number of years ago on the 29th. I put table and chairs in my truck and set up in the parking lot, and we had a meal in the parking lot. So we drove to Paxton, to the Paxton Inn, because we did that on our first date. We drove all the way into Auburn to go bowling because we went bowling on our first date. And so we went all of these different places. Anyway, back to Judges. This is where we left off. We were talking in Judges, and I took a sidetrack on remembering, but here's where we are in Judges, looking at Joseph and God speaking. Let's just expand that out and start working through that text. So this is what that text looks like, and we're going to look at it in three different sections. Luz, the city of Luz, we're going to take a look at that. And that takes us from verse 22 to 26. And then we're going to look at the middle section. It's a little bit bigger, but we're not going to spend too much time there. And that's verses 27 till the end of chapter 1. And then we're going to look at what God speaks, chapter 2, verses 1 through verse 5. Okay? So that's what we're looking at. And so we begin by looking at the city of Luz. I'm just thinking. We then drove over to the Auburn High School. And we took a picture over through the roof of the Jeep. That's not the school that she went to. That school's gone and demolished. It's a whole new school now. We went to Auburn, and then we drove down the road because Annie and I went to the senior prom, her senior prom together at the Yankee Drummer, and that's what it looks like, today, the Yankee Drummer. We used to go out for dinner together every single Friday at a small restaurant called Andrea's. It's now the Galway Pub, but we took a picture there. But this was an Italian kind of restaurant. We went there every Friday. One day do you know where this is? She doesn't know I'm throwing these up here. It's Florida, exactly. So we were driving around and we decided, where do you want to go? And we decided, let's go to Florida. Well, we didn't have the money, the time, or anything to go to Florida. So this is on Stafford Street. There's like this side street that goes over there. We just pulled in. We called it Florida. And we just spent hours just talking and pretending we were in Florida. Whenever we drive by there, we think about how we went to Florida. Okay, anyway, back to Judges. We were at this city called Luz. So let's dig into that. Here's what the scriptures say. Now the house of Joseph attacked Bethel, and the Lord was with them. So God is with them, but what we do see is that the first instance when Judah is there, Judah goes to God and says, who should go first? There's this inquiry to God. And here we don't see the inquiry. It doesn't mean there wasn't one, but the author is choosing to not highlight it if there was one. But God is with them. And they sent men to spy out Bethel, formerly called Luz. So we're reminded that this is written in the future, at the time of kings, at the time of one of the exiles, most likely the first exile. And so here we see that they spy out this land, this city called Luz. The spies saw a man coming out of the city, and they said to him, show us how to get into the city, and we'll see that you're treated well. This kind of reminds and would remind the people reading this in that day, perhaps it reminds you of Jericho, when Joshua goes into Jericho, and he makes a covenant, kind of a deal with Rahab the prostitute to protect them and to hide them. So here they made a deal, and says, show us how to get into the city, and we'll see that you're treated well. So he showed them. And they put the city to the sword, but spared the man and his whole family. He then went to the land of the Hittites, where he built a city and called it Luz, which is its name to this day. So a very big difference between what happened with Rahab, with Joshua at Jericho, and the city of Luz that happens in the book of Judges. You see, in Joshua, Rahab becomes one of the Israelites. Rahab becomes one of the people in the line, in the genealogy of Jesus. So Rahab is brought into Israel. But here we see a deal being made, and they let this person go, he and his family, which has to be more than just brother and sister, and they go to a place north with where the Hittites are, and they build another Luz. Nothing changes. With the land goes the gods. And so Rahab joins Israel and worships the God of Israel, and this person goes to another place and starts another city with the same gods that later, if we did a study on the kings of Israel, we'd find that this was problematic for David. So they didn't do what they were supposed to do. And so now we move into this middle part here. Did not and allowed, I called it. They didn't do and they allowed other things. And so let's dig into that and just kind of look at that. But let's remember a little bit more of our day of remembering. We drove to the Auburn Mall to the jewelry store because that's where I bought the ring. I've told the story before. You know, I had her try it on, make sure it was everything she wanted. And then I just said, could you wrap it up? And then I proposed to her in the parking lot of the Auburn Mall. And then we started planning the wedding. And as we planned the wedding, Annie's mom took control. I mean, she took all control. And so you may wonder why the driving range is a place of remembrance in our relationship. Well, every time I got really ticked off at her mom, I went and whacked a bucket of balls. They knew me by name. So we, on our day of remembrance, we went to the Auburn driving range because many a times I said, Ann, let's go. I gotta hit a bucket of balls. Let's go. We were married in Auburn at St. Joseph's Church. And then we had pictures taken at Elm Park. And the whole wedding party lined up on a different bridge because that one fell apart and they had to build another one. And then we had our wedding reception at the Elks over on Mill Street. And just this week, was it this week or last week? We drove by there to see that that's closed down too. Anyway, back to the book of Judges. We were looking at that middle section, the middle section of did not and allowed. So let's expand that and let's look at that. The first thing that we see when we look at this section is an awful lot of yellow where they did not and red where they allowed something to happen that they shouldn't. There's this theme going on. So let's just walk through, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time, and I'm not going to try to pronounce the names, because I'm probably just not good at it. But I just want you to focus on the allows and the did nots. It's striking. But Manasseh did not, there it is, did not drive out the people of Beth-shan, or Tanakh, or Dor, or Eblam, or Megiddo, and the surrounding settlements, for the Canaanites were determined to live in that land. So they did not, how many times? They did not to Beth-shan, to Tanakh, to Dor, to Eblam, to Megiddo, and the surrounding settlements. So six different places they did not. So somebody, I didn't count them, somebody keep track, six did nots. When Israel became strong, they pressed the Canaanites into forced labor, but never drove them out completely. So there's a did not. The forced labor issue, there's a there's an issue that is culture that we need to think about. We can address, and maybe we will address the issue of slavery here, but as I said, the culture, this was practice within culture. When you stepped into an area, you annihilated them, and if you were if you had mercy, you forced them into slavery. Okay, so there's a did not, and neither did Zebulun. This is another son of Jacob, a descendant of. So neither did Zebulun drive out the Canaanites living in Kitron and Naalal. So there's two places who remained among them, but they did not subject them to forced labor. So again, they're living with them, and they did not. There's three more. Nor did Asher, another son of the descendant of Jacob, nor did Asher drive out those living in Akko, or Sidon, or Ahab, or Akzib, or Helbar, or Aphek, or Rahob. So there's seven more. And because of this, the people of Asher lived among the Canaanite inhabitants of the land. They weren't supposed to live among them. And so here we go to verse 33. Neither did Naphtali, another son, the descendant of Jacob, drive out those living in Beth Shemesh and Beth Anath. But the Naphtalites, another son, too, lived among the Canaanite inhabitants of the land, and those living in Beth Shemesh and Beth Anath became forced laborers for them. So now there's two more sons that didn't do it and two more locations. The Amorites confined the Danites. So the Danites is another tribe of the descendants of Jacob. Then the Danites don't even push them out. They're prevented from even going into the land. So the Amorites confined the Danites to hill country, not allowing them to come down into the plain. And the Amorites were determined also to hold out in Mount Heres, Abjon, Shalbim. But then the power of the house of Joseph increased, and they too were pressed into forced labor. And so another three, is that, did I count three? So what's the total? Did you have them all in? No? Okay. A lot. So a lot of not doing what they were supposed to do. And interesting how the writer writes this next line. The boundary of the Amorites was from Scorpion Pass to Selah and beyond. The fact that the author is highlighting the borders of who were supposed to not be there, that would be like if somehow we were in a conflict with Canada, and at the end of it all, the author writing about our history says, and the borders of Canada existed from here to here. It's saying that things continuously went bad. With Judah, when we looked at Judah, they were successful. Here, they continuously get worse and worse and worse. And so now we move to the place where God speaks to them. And so let's dig into that. But let's just remember a little bit more about our day. So this is where we lived when we first got married. It was a cottage. It was really a 1.5-car garage that was made into an apartment. It was awesome. It was $150 a month for rent. There was no insulation in it. Snow never landed on the roof. You could see heat waves coming off of the roof in the wintertime. But I remember the landlady just loved us, and she had to increase the rent to $170. And she said, if it's too much, I won't do it. So that's where we lived in Millbury. And another place was Faith Baptist Church. This is the chapel area. But our lives really were transformed, you know, attending services here and that the Carpenter's Workshop, which used to be, you know, here, but that's Greenville Baptist Church's new building. And so we went to the Carpenter's Workshop, and we drove to Worcester State College because we did ministry together there for so many years. And then we went to St. Vincent's Hospital, and this is the only side of the building that still exists. The rest of the building is gone. And you know, we just remembered about the difficult times there, losing a loved one. The birth of each of our kids happened there. And then we went from there, we drove to Westminster to the Old Mill. It's a pretty cool restaurant that we go to for celebrating different things. And it was a day, you know, of remembering. And you know, if I'm trying to counsel someone, you know, that where they're having problems, I often walk through this kind of a process, remembering. Go through a process of remembering. You know, ask yourself if you're on track at each of those locations, because if you can kind of diagnose where things went wrong, then you can talk about how to get back on track. If, you know, what are the consequences and the choices that need to be made? A day of remembering, it's a healthy thing to do, whether you're struggling or not even struggling. It's a good way to stay on track. Anyway, back to the book of Judges. We were at that place where God was speaking, so let's expand that. And here we see the angel of the Lord. Just to highlight that for a second, over 50 times in the New Testament, that term shows up, an angel of the Lord. Usually this shows up very abruptly. Here it is, and suddenly you're in the presence of God. I'm not going to go into this more because it comes up multiple times in the book of Judges, and I want to address that then when that comes up. But just know, the angel of the Lord is a very significant thing. So the angel of the Lord went up from Gilgal to Bochim and said, I brought you up out of Egypt and led you into the land that I swore to give your forefathers. I brought you up out of Egypt. You were in bondage for 400 years. I rescued you. I saved you. I brought you across the Red Sea, dry land. All of the Pharaoh's army was drowned as the sea collapsed on them. The highest and biggest moment, you know, that they have in their history of God acting in a powerful way to them. And so the writer brings this out, you know, remembering what the angel of the Lord said. And tells us, I swore to your forefathers, I said that I would never break my covenant with you, and you shall not make a covenant with the people of this land, but you shall break down their altars. And this is the thrust of Joshua's conquest. This is the thrust of Judges, is to cast out the idols, the false gods, the terrible things that are happening in the name of their deity, to cast them out and to bring in the God of Israel. And so God is saying, I said that I would never break my covenant with you, and you shall not make a covenant with people of this land. But they just did. We saw it. And then it goes on, yet you have disobeyed me. Why have you done this? Now, therefore, I tell you that I will not drive them out before you. They will be thorns in your sides, and their gods will be a snare to you. Well, it might not stand out to you, but I am certain that the reader at the time that this was written sees this verse as something bigger, something more. The way that the word is displayed in here, you have disobeyed me. Why have you done this? That's verse 2. In the text that you have in your books, what does it say? Verse 2. Okay, thank you. What is this you have done is far better. What is this you have done? The NIV, the nearly inspired version they called it in seminary. The NIV says, "Now therefore I tell you, I will not drive them out." Why have you done this? That's what I'm focusing on. The NIV says, "Why have you done this?" And the ESV said, just that verse, what is it again?
What is this you have done?
What is this you have done? And then he goes on to talk about the nations will be thorns in their side. I want to point you to Genesis. When God addresses Eve for having partaken of the fruit, he says to Eve, what is this you have done? Same Hebrew. The same. And then what happens very shortly after that, just a few verses after that in Genesis, at the curse? Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil you will eat of it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns. And so Adam and Eve sin. God says, what have you done? And the results, the consequence of that is a life of labor, a life of having to work, and a life of dealing with the thorns. And so then we move into Judges, and we see the angel of God, the angel of the Lord saying, you have disobeyed me. Why have you done this? What have you done? Now therefore I tell you that I will not drive them out before you. They will be thorns. And it, no more is the promised land going to be the land of milk and honey and utopia type of environment. No longer is that going to happen. No longer is this garden going to exist where you are able to just plant and grow and pick and eat, but there will be thorns, there will be thistles, and there will be nations. They will be thorns in your side, and they will be thistles to you, and you will have to deal with them as a result of your disobedience. It's a parallel. And then verse 4 says, when the angel of the Lord had spoken these things to all of the Israelites, the people wept aloud. They were convicted of their disobedience. They were convicted. They saw the connection. Perhaps some saw the connection back to the fall, back to Adam and Eve, all the way back. Maybe God is bringing them to this place of remembering. And so here we see the angel of the Lord speaking, and the people wept out loud, and I'm sure some of them were repentative, and some of them were just weeping because now they have to deal with all of this, the consequences of it. I'm sure that there's a mix of people. But what's interesting is that they then called the place Bochim. But wait a minute, they called it Bochim at the top. So did they just start calling this? And why is that Bochim there? And then they wept, and then they called it Bochim. Well, we have to realize and remember, the writer is writing this on the other side of things. The writer is helping the reader to have a day of remembering. The writer is helping the reader to say, look at what happened. Go back. Look. Look at what happened in the garden. Look at what happened in Egypt. Look at what happened. And so what we find here in this text is that the writer, the Spirit of God, and the writer of the text, that they're remembering their covenant. God is saying, remember the covenant that you made with me. God is saying, remember that covenant. He's saying, remember our relationship. He's saying, remember what you've done wrong and where you went wrong. He's challenging the readers of this to apply it to their lives at the time of the kings because they're about to do it again. Remember the consequences and remember that you had a choice. They had a choice of that day to continue on. And what we're going to find in the book of Judges that their weeping was shallow. That their weeping was not this kind of repentance that had any form of lasting benefit. And so as we walk through all of what we're doing today, and as we continue to be thinking and we're reminded of remembering, and you're remembering Annie and my story, and you're remembering the story of God up to the point where the person is writing the book of Judges, but today is Palm Sunday. And today is a day of remembering. Today is a day of remembering. And so we need to be thinking about remembering the conception. Remembering how the Holy Spirit came upon Mary and that Jesus was conceived of God. Remembering his birth. Remembering the King of Kings, the creator and author of life, being laid in a manger. We need to remember this story and draw in the joy that it experienced that we have. We need to remember the baptism that we saw of Christ, where the Father, the Son, and the Spirit came together, forming a clear picture of the Trinity to us. We need to remember the choosing of the disciples, that Jesus called into action everyday people like fishermen, like tax collectors, like you. That Jesus calls us into his epic journey. We need to be remembering that today. We need to be remembering the first miracle of turning the water into wine, symbolic of what was going to be turned into the wine that brings us forgiveness. We need to be remembering the shifting of the focus away from the temple and to Christ. Destroy this temple, Jesus said, and I will rebuild it in 3 days. And he's talking about the temple of his body. He shifts the focus away from the temple. He shifts the focus of the Sabbath feasts. This is a list that we came up with in the Gospel of John when we were looking through it. He shifted the focus of all of the Sabbath feasts to be a fulfillment of it. His treatment of women. We need to understand how he stepped in and broke the norms and began to create a new thought that would bring about radical change, his treatment of outsiders, the Samaritans, his treatment of the Gentiles. We need to be thinking about and remembering this life of Jesus, that he claimed to be the bread of life, the light of the world, the resurrection, the gate, the good shepherd, the way, the truth, and the life, taken from my favorite chapter in all of Scripture, the vine. We need to remember his teaching. We need to remember how he cared for the sick, the poor, the widow, the prisoner, the disenfranchised, the tax collectors, the prostitutes, the sinners. We need to remember how he rejected an offer to be made king after feeding the 5,000. He had an offer. They were going to make him king, and he walked away because it wasn't his time. And we need to remember that he didn't claim the throne on Palm Sunday. He claimed it on the cross. And this is the week that we enter into now. And this week is a week of days of remembering. As Lent has been a series of weeks of remembering, we now move into a week of days of remembering. I invite you to watch as they play.
I saw your perfection in my
This week is a week of days of remembering. And we need to be remembering Christ in our lives. If you don't know Christ, if this is something new to you, open the Gospel of John. Begin reading this week and have your own days of remembering. Remember your life and how it parallels the walk of Christ. And spend some time remembering. Are you on track? Where did you go wrong? What consequences, what choices are necessary for you to make? This week is a week of days of remembering. Join us on Thursday for our communion service. Come in on Friday and spend some time praying, silently reflecting, remembering. Worship with us on Easter when the recovery is made crystal clear in the resurrection. But this week, let us approach it carefully and let us remember. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your recovery offered to us freely. Help us to remember the places where our love was fueled, where our relationship was strong, where we were inseparable. And then, Lord, show us where we were not so close. Show us, Lord, where we need to move to be on track. May this week, for me, for all of us, be a week of days of remembering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have our closing hymn. If you are making an offering as part of your worship, there are offering plates at each exit. But let's stand for our closing hymn. benediction, a reading from Scripture to descend on us, to convict us, to challenge us as we move from here into our families, the world, our neighborhood, our places of employ. Taken from Mark chapter 11, verses 7 through 10. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches that they had cut in the fields. Those who were ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest." Father, we thank you for these words. You are the King. We are your subjects. Empower us to go forth remembering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.